Line Philippines.
We were lucky to have filmed in South America and Europe, plus some new ones now that destinations in the Philippines are starting to open up.
Marie Lozano and Martin Avera.
Expect the unexpected as we talk to some of your favorite people and turn their long stories into short stories.
As all new episodes of Executive Class, Cityscape, and LSS The Martin Avera Show return on a new time slot. Only here on ANC.
In 2018, Daya was able to document the punok. A punok is declared at the end of the harvest season in this area of Ifugao.
We should have say thank you to our Maknongan, to our God, for the many blessings for our abundant harvest.
Dadya and bundesyon de waga si bago ya waga si kabunyan ang tuntutu kipodan si tago. Makigay gayom din amin, munaayam din munil tuturang din amin. Kepin ho di maknungan bago ang wadahagot.
Dayaw, our knowledge, our pride.
The world has come to a full stop. But we haven't stopped learning. Exploring. Dreaming. And living.
Michelle Long, it's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines, Wall Street rises for a second straight day as the Fed stands on tapering, calmed investors. Asian shares set for a higher open as investors await clarity on China's Evergrande situation. Here at home, the PSEI back at the 6,900 level after extending gains for a third straight session. Is it going to be a weekly gain or a loss this week? Royce Aguilar of First Metro Securities joins us for a market outlook. The Philippine Central Bank keeps key interest rates at record lows, looking past increasing inflation pressures. And the U.S. plans to take a more aggressive stance to address the worsening shortage in semiconductor chips. We begin with the financial markets. Wall Street rallied for a second straight day as investors appeared relieved about the U.S. Federal Reserve stance on tapering stimulus and raising interest rates. All the major indices adding more than 1% each, with the Dow gaining over 500 points. Energy stocks, meanwhile, boosted the S&P 500. Now, Thursday's rally pushed Wall Street back into the green this week. Meanwhile, oil prices jumping, supported by growing fuel demand and a draw in U.S. crude inventories as production remained hampered in the Gulf of Mexico after two hurricanes. Now, on the data front, investors shrugging off a rise in weekly U.S. jobless claims, the number of Americans filing for unemployment benefits jumping to 351,000, well ahead of the 320,000 estimate.
I think it's quite positive. It's telling you that investors continue to want to engage with the market. They still want to believe the recovery story, that there's more to come in the normalization of our commercial lives. And the quick snapback, I think, is evidence of that. Investors still are, at their core, remain quite bullish and quite positive.
Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all the major indices pointing to extended gains when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Now, over here in Asia, stocks are on the rise as well, taking cues from Wall Street's overnight rally. As you can see, Japan's Nikkei 225 is up by nearly 2% as markets there return to trade following Thursday's holiday. South Korea's Kospi Index also up 0.6%. Australia's ASX 200 also edging higher. Turning now to the Evergrande crisis. Now, on Thursday, shares of Evergrande jumped more than 17% after its chairman said the firm's top priority now is to help wealth investors redeem their products. But bondholders are still awaiting information about the key interest payment worth $83.5 million, which was due on Thursday. Will they be paid? Well, there's been no announcement about that payment as of market close in New York. Evergrande also has a $47.5 million bond interest payment due next week. Both offshore bonds would default if the company fails to settle the interest within 30 days of the scheduled payment dates. Investors fear Evergrande's rot could spread to creditors, including banks in China and abroad. But analysts have been downplaying that risk that the collapse would result in a so-called Lehman moment for China's Evergrande or a systemic liquidity crunch. Now, looking at other corporate news, Twitter starting to allow high-profile users to get tips in Bitcoin as the network steps up its wooing of content creators. And we've also got Nike posting first quarter sales that missed estimates as production and shipping delays hobbled the company's efforts to meet strong demand. In other news, Taiwan flags a potential roadblock to its bid in joining the Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership if China joins first. This report tells us why.
Taiwan is worried a political roadblock from China may prevent it from joining a Trans-Pacific Trade Pact. The self-ruled island filed its application to join the Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership, or CPTPP, on Wednesday, a week after Beijing submitted its application. Taiwan's chief trade negotiator John Deng said on Thursday there could be potential problems ahead.
China has continuously been limiting Taiwan's space for international activity. I think everyone has observed this. Therefore, if China joins the agreement first, Taiwan's membership application will of course be quite at risk.
Taiwan has applied to join the CPTPP under the name the Separate Customs Territory of Taiwan, Penghu, Jinan, and Matsu. It's the same name it uses for its membership in the World Trade Organization. But Beijing has always insisted Taiwan is part of its territory rather than a separate country. That's led to Taiwan being excluded from many international bodies. Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson Zhao Lijian on Thursday hit back at Taiwan's bid to join the pact.
We resolutely oppose any country's official exchanges with Taiwan and resolutely oppose the Taiwan region's accession to any official agreements and organizations.
The CPTPP's precursor, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, was originally a 12-member agreement, seen as an important economic counterweight to China's growing influence. But it was thrown into limbo in early 2017, when then-US President Donald Trump withdrew.
The U.S. wants to take a more aggressive stance to address the worsening shortage in semiconductor chips. Automakers have been forced to cut production due to the shortage, affecting thousands of U.S. workers. Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo says government will need to better anticipate where supply chain bottlenecks occur. But she also called on Congress to do its part in resolving the issue.
The situation is not getting better. In some ways, it's getting worse. Truck companies, car companies have furloughed and continue to furlough thousands of workers. So it's time to get more aggressive. The RFI will give us information about the supply chain, and the goal is to increase transparency so we can try to...
Chargers will also be sold separately from electronic devices. The EU says it was not targeting Apple, and it only acted because companies were not able to agree on a common solution despite a decade of talks.
It's not at all against innovation. By the way, it's not against anyone. It is just like everything we do, and like everything I do as a commissioner and everything we do in commission, it's for the consumers.
But Apple is pushing back against the proposal since iPhones are charged from lightning cables, while Android devices are charged using USB-C connectors. Back here at home, the Philippine Central Bank keeps key interest rates at record lows, looking past increasing inflation pressures in a bid to spur economic recovery. It maintained the interest rate for overnight reverse repurchase facility at a record low of 2% for the seventh straight meeting. Interest rates on overnight deposit and lending facilities were also capped at 1.5% and 2.5%. The central bank also revising the country's 2021 inflation forecast to 4.4%, that is up from the previous 4.1% estimate. Biden asserts inflation expectations remain firmly aligned with their projections.
On balance, the Monetary Board is of the view that prevailing monetary policy settings remain appropriate given the manageable inflation environment and uncertain growth outlook. The Monetary Board reiterates that, together with appropriate fiscal and health interventions, keeping a steady hand on the BSP's policy levers will allow the momentum of economic recovery to gain more traction by helping boost domestic demand and market confidence.
President Rodrigo Duterte signs a law setting up a tax regime for Philippine offshore gaming operators, or POGOs. Under the measure, 60% of revenues collected from offshore gambling will be used for the Universal Healthcare Program. 20% will go to the enhancement of medical facilities, while the remaining 20% will be allotted for sustainable development goals. Senator Pia Cayetano earlier said POGOs yielded 6.4 billion pesos in collections back in 2019. They were suspended in 2020, along with other non-essential businesses, when the COVID-19 lockdown was imposed. Meralco will resume disconnection activities in Metro Manila starting next week. This after the capital region shifted to a looser pandemic alert level quarantine system. But Meralco assures the public those under granular lockdowns will not be affected by disconnection activities. Disconnection activities also are suspended in Bulacan, Cavite, Laguna, Rizal, Lucena City, and Quezon, which remain under modified enhanced community quarantine until September 30. Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today, Friday. Malaysia will come out with its August inflation rate. Consumer prices in Malaysia declined to 2.2% in July. This was the lowest inflation rate since March, mainly due to the monthly electricity discount given to domestic consumers amid the COVID-19 lockdown. Singapore will report its August manufacturing output. Now, Singapore's manufacturing production grew by 16.3% in July, missing market forecasts of 20.2%. And from Europe, Italy will come out with its September consumer confidence figures. Consumer confidence there fell to 116.2 in August, but it still beat forecasts and remains well above pre-pandemic levels. September 30. Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today, Friday. Malaysia will come out with its August inflation rate. Consumer prices in Malaysia declined to 2.2% in July. This was the lowest inflation rate since March, mainly due to the monthly electricity discount given to domestic consumers amid the COVID-19 lockdown. Singapore will report its August manufacturing output. Now, Singapore's manufacturing production grew by 16.3% in July, missing market forecasts of 20.2%. And from Europe, Italy will come out with its September consumer confidence figures. Consumer confidence there fell to 116.2 in August, but it still beat forecasts and remains well above pre-pandemic levels. Think tank Fitch Solutions earlier this month came out with a report that projects that the local construction industry will grow 24% this year and 16% next year, in both instances beating the economy and the growth it's seeing. This, it said, will be driven by transport infrastructure, particularly rail and road development. WorldBeck's managing director, Jill Ang, now joins us live. Hi, Jill. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, Mimi. Thank you for having me. Good morning.
Good morning. So let's talk about infrastructure, because this is what you guys are all about, the construction space. What's the infrastructure building demand like right now? Is it still choppy, or has demand picked up right back to where it was before COVID-19 hit us?
I think it's slowly picking up, Mimi, especially with the government's build project. I think they're already rolling it out. I think it's also one of the programs that would also help the government restart the economy.
Mm-hmm. And you're seeing this in sales, in construction material sales.
Yeah, eventually all projects are continuing already, and there are new projects coming in as well.
Okay.
It's already a good sign for the economy, I think.
Okay, and this is great because you guys are holding the WorldBEX. Could you tell us how this is going to play out? This is going to be a wired event, right? It's digital.
Yes, it's a digital event. It opened yesterday. It will be until Sunday, September 26th. So basically, the WorldBEX Wired platform features different interactive activities and services that would also help the companies interact with their target audience. So we have the business matching sessions, we have the product demos, and we also have the seminars, wherein international and local speakers share their knowledge with regards to the latest trends and technology when it comes to the building and design industry.
I'm very curious, before we go back to the construction conversation, Jill, what's it like organizing these big events that used to be physical events and now moving digital? Are the margins better?
Yeah, it's somewhat difficult, but at the end of the day, we have to adapt to the new normal, as they say. As of now, since restrictions are still being imposed and with the current pandemic, everybody has to pivot and make sure that safety is utmost prioritized.
Mm-hmm. Are the margins better because you don't have to lease out big spaces and you can now reach more people, but are you able to demand the same amount of pricing from those?
It's almost out? The same, Mimi, because we have to invest with technology, which is also a different sector. Mm-hmm. Altogether, in terms of logistics, in terms of like coordination, I think it's almost the same in a way.
And when you look at the size of this event that you're holding right now, the exhibitors and the participants, would you say they are more now that you don't have the physical barriers, or more or less the same? Construction conversation. We hear a lot about supply chain disruptions, bottlenecks, shortages of some construction materials that could be causing inflation. Prices are going up fast for a vast number of materials. Policymakers are saying, don't worry, this is all going to roll over. The price increases are transitory. Do you agree that these price increases, the inflationary pressure is transitory, or do you think that a lot of these price increases will be here to stay for the long term?
I think it will be transitory. I think as soon as the pandemic probably eases out and the restrictions, I think eventually the supply of essential goods would eventually roll back and goes back to normal.
Okay, goes back to normal. Looking to the future, Jill, I'm not sure if you guys are showcasing this, but the future of construction, how does that look like? I mean, are we talking about automatic, autonomous construction robots, shipping containers used as building blocks for constructing houses and buildings? Anything else that you're seeing in innovations over the next 5 to 10 year horizon?
Yeah, I think it's slowly starting up. Like in terms of technology, AIs are already a thing now, especially I think in most industries, it's being explored already. And it's something that everybody has to watch out for.
Mm-hmm. And will AI be part of the showcase this year?
We have some companies who feature software, so the audience probably might check it out also.
Mm-hmm. I want to end the conversation, Jill, on CSR, corporate social responsibility. Now, be a buzzword. It's just a mixed combination of letters, but now it means more. It's your role in nation building. aside from building the nation's infrastructure, your industry is also into going big into nation building. In fact, I know that you guys, WorldBex, you're one of the biggest donors of the ABS-CBN Foundation. Is that correct?
Yeah. Ever since before the pandemic started, we've been helping the ABS-CBN Foundations with all their projects and with all their advocacies, especially during this time of the pandemic. WorldBex and together with our company partners is committed to still support them in spite of all the challenges in order to help our fellow Filipinos.
Mm-hmm. And that's on your part. What about on the part of consumers? Are consumers willing to pay up for more expensive products that are said to be more sustainable, greener products, construction materials?
Yeah, I think there's already a shift. People right now are more conscious in terms of like environment and like I think climate change is one of the aspects that everyone is talking about right now. And I think everyone is creating a conscious effort in order to save the earth and eventually save it for future generations.
Mm-hmm. Building and building green. Jill, thank you so much for joining us this morning. It was a pleasure to speak with you and good luck with your event.
Thank you, Mimi. And I hope to see all of you there. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. The provinces of Abra and Bohol, as well as Baguio City, placed under general community quarantine with heightened restrictions amid a rise in COVID cases. Malacañang says this will stay in effect until the end of the month. Under the stricter guidelines, dine-in services, personal care, religious gatherings, and outdoor tourist attractions will be allowed to operate at limited capacity. But even before the tighter quarantine was announced, the province of Benguet had already imposed stricter health protocols. Benguet was earlier flagged by the Okta Research Group as an area of concern.
So essential travel na tayo yung ginagawa natin. Nag-check na sa border yan, kaya yung pila.
The provinces of Abra and Bohol, as well as Baguio City, placed under general community quarantine with heightened restrictions amid a rise in COVID cases. Malacañang says this will stay in effect until the end of the month. Under the stricter guidelines, dine-in services, personal care, religious gatherings, and outdoor tourist attractions will be allowed to operate at limited capacity. But even before the tighter quarantine was announced, the province of Benguet had already imposed stricter health protocols. Benguet was earlier flagged by the Okta Research Group as an area of concern.
So essential travel na tayo yung ginagawa natin. Nag-check na sa border yan, kaya yung pila namin na mga sasakyan mahaba na.
Kung pwede po, itantan muna ang pag-travel dito sa Benguet. Itong mabilis ang pagtaas ng kaso ng COVID ay for our safety din naman po.
Meanwhile, Ilocos Norte has been de-escalated from a modified enhanced community quarantine to general community quarantine. The Philippines logged 17,411 new COVID-19 cases on Thursday, raising the nationwide tally to 2,434,000. 177 more patients died, while 14,000 recovered. The number of active cases stands at more than 165,000. The health department says the occupancy rate of intensive care units across the country has now reached a record high of 79%. But apart from a shortage in hospital beds, manpower is also a big issue. President Rodrigo Duterte earlier ordered the deployment of police and military medical personnel to health facilities in need of additional staff. Quezon City inspects 13 orphanages and rehabilitation centers following a series of COVID-19 outbreaks in closed and long-term care facilities. Four religious compounds have been placed under special lockdown due to COVID-19. Quezon City's Epidemiology and Surveillance Unit says they're already looking into COVID-19 related deaths among the personnel of these facilities. Mayor Joy Belmonte, meanwhile, says the local government will also prioritize vaccinating residents of religious compounds. Now, over in the U.S., an advisory panel of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention recommends booster shots of Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine. The recommendation only covers Americans aged 65 and up older and some adults with underlying medical conditions, leaving out adults who live or work in institutions considered high risk for COVID-19. The decision, which comes a day after the U.S. Food and Drug Administration authorized the booster shots, clears the way for a booster rollout as soon as this week for those who had their second dose of Pfizer shot at least 6 months ago. Up next, can Philippine shares extend gains for a fourth straight session? We'll find out. Are we going to end the week on a high note? Royce Aguilar of First Metro Securities joins us for some market perspective when Market Edge returns.
Dimensional, multi-layered approach now needed in this part of our battle in this pandemic.
Vaccines, they remain highly effective in preventing severe disease, hospitalization, and death.
So how much of a game changer will that be for us here in the Philippines if we see children get vaccinated against COVID-19?
Catch ANC Presents COVID-19 in Numbers with Carmina Constantino and Edson Guido. Only here on ANC.
The biggest news, the most compelling stories, and issues that matter to you. Top Story, Monday to Saturday at 5 p.m. here on A.
You're still watching Market Edge, the headlines. Wall Street rises for a second straight day as the Fed's stance on tapering calmed investors. Asian shares open higher as investors await clarity on Evergrande's situation. Here at home, the PSE index back at the 6,900 level after extending gains for a third straight session. Is it going to be a weekly gain this week or a weekly loss? We're going to ask Royce Aguilar of First Metro Securities, who's going to be joining us for a market outlook. The Philippine Central Bank keeps key interest rates at record lows as expected, looking past increasing inflation pressures. And the U.S. plans to take a more aggressive stance to address the worsening shortage in semiconductor chips. The Philippine Stock Exchange begins trading at 69.40, up nearly 0.4% in the first 2 minutes of trade. For the day, joining us today for his take on the markets, Royce Aguilar of First Metro Securities, joining us live all the way from Maryland, USA. Hi, Royce. Good morning. It's good evening there, right?
Yes. Good evening and good morning, everyone. Hi, Mimi. Hi, everyone.
Okay, so I want to start with Wall Street because you came from Wall Street a few days ago. Yeah. Between the Fed that's turning a little bit more hawkish now, and the debt crisis brewing at China's Evergrande Group.
That's right.
And of course, the race to vaccinate the world. What's the mood like there in the U.S. market-wise?
It's a good thing you mentioned that because the theme that investors are watching right now are still the timing of the raising of interest rates. As you all know, it seems like the dot plot has been pointed at the earlier date to 2022 compared to 2023 last June. Mm-hmm. And then you also mentioned that the Evergrande crisis is still on the horizon for investors, especially in the near term. But if you take a look at Wall Street, it has rebounded quite well in the past few days despite the ongoing risks. If you take a look at both reopening and tech names are really driving the markets. And based on my situation here, actually, it makes sense because the situation here is pretty much normal. You see a lot of people are eating at restaurants. A lot of people are going to notable tourist spots, right? So I can see the future of the Philippines, especially once we reach herd immunity. Basically, so I'm quite excited on what might happen in the Philippines in the near future because I can see it now here in the US.
Wow. Okay. Hopefully happening sooner rather than later. But I'm pretty sure while you're there, you also have to cover the central bank policy meeting yesterday.
Right.
The Philippine Central Bank kept policy rates unchanged for a seventh straight meeting. Is this good news for the market or is the market neutral at this point?
I think at this point, it's neutral because it is expected. The BSP is not yet expected to move the rates anytime soon, right? Although you will see inflation reach, it came in at 4.9%, right, in the recent month. But I think what people are seeing, it's transitory, right? So it's still neutral, right? It's not out of the control. I think that's the thing. If it's still within control, I think the BSP is not yet pressured to make some any moves. So bottom line is, to answer your question, it's neutral.
Okay, neutral. The BSP may be neutral. So what's going to lead the way higher for the PSE index? We're now up over 0.5% for September, but we're still down 3% year to date.
Yeah. Actually, to be fair, since August, the market has performed quite well, has been resilient. I think I would describe the market as resilient despite the ongoing risk, but 7,000 is still a key resistance, and it needs more catalyst. So to answer your question, it needs further economic reopening. We understand that in terms of, you know, branding of definition of the restrictions, we're under GCQ, but we're at alert level 4, where it feels like we're under MECQ, right? So there's still ongoing restrictions, and the market is still awaiting for further reopening. But of course, that's still hinged on lower cases, and that's also hinged on higher vaccination rates, which is still ongoing. So there.
Okay, so 7,000 is the key resistance. Looking at how the situation is in the Philippines with vaccination rates, we're starting to pick up. We're now at 16% fully vaccinated population, although hopefully we could get that number up sooner. You've got cases remaining elevated. Do we deserve the level we're in, 6,900? Is this fair value?
Well, at the end of the day, the market's relatively cheap, and we have been relatively been battered compared to the other regions. So right now, the market is justifiable at this current level. So of course, we expect more upside in the coming months, in the coming 12 to 24 months, right? But of course, that's hinged on better situation, which we have yet to, you know, see. So right now, the market is still justifiable, and there's still upside ahead, but we still have to wait for those catalysts to really come into play.
Okay, let's go over some interesting corporate stories. Cebu Pacific urging LGUs to please simplify the travel rules and remove RT-PCR requirement for vaccinated travelers. The airlines, what's the outlook for them? Are they closer to the end of the tunnel or still somewhere down there?
Well, I wouldn't say they're close to the end of the tunnel. I wouldn't also say that they're down there, right in the middle. Right. Actually, if you take a look at the outlook of Cebu Pacific, they're cautiously optimistic in terms of the capacity. It's improving, but it's still far from the norm. Yeah. Right. So I think compared to our expectation, because if you will know that our picks are property banking, which those are the sectors that we expect to rebound first. And then probably after that, the airlines will come after that. So the tourism play and the like. So at the end of the day, just like what I've mentioned earlier, the vaccination, the further reopening, those are the catalysts, especially for tourism. But the point here is, in our view, based from our data, that consumers have the capacity. It's just a matter of the restrictions being eased. So that should be a good news for Cebu Pacific. So something to be excited about, but not in the near term yet.
Mm-hmm. Cautiously optimistic. Cebu Pacific has been trying to bring up the number of their domestic flights to Bohol, right, to Boracay, to Siargao. But as you mentioned, the capacity is still not there because right now they're just operating about half of their fleet of 73 aircraft. That's another right. Interesting story here, this time from Jollibee. Jollibee is looking to raise some 12 billion pesos by selling preferred shares at 1,000 pesos each. This was the news from yesterday.
At the end of the day, just like what I've mentioned earlier, the vaccination, the further reopening, those are the catalysts, especially for tourism. But the point here is, in our view, based from our data, that consumers have the capacity. It's just a matter of the restrictions being eased. So that should be a good news for Cebu Pacific. So something to be excited about, but not in the near term yet.
Mm-hmm. Cautiously optimistic. Cebu Pacific has been trying to bring up the number of their domestic flights to Bohol, right, to Boracay, to Siargao. But as you mentioned, the capacity is still not there because right now they're just operating about half of their fleet of 73 aircraft. That's another right. Interesting story here, this time from Jollibee. Jollibee is looking to raise some 12 billion pesos by selling preferred shares at 1,000 pesos each. This was the news from yesterday. And they're also looking to expand in Canada with a mobile kitchen in Ontario and a new branch in Winnipeg, And that's their 18th branch in Canada. The goal, of course, is to hit 500 stores in North America over the next few years. Jollibee, and it used to be the darling. I remember at the time, a time when Jollibee was considered the most expensive consumer stock. It was darling stock. It has fallen ever since. Do you think it's going to go back to the golden days when it was the stock to have, to hold?
I think it can return to the golden days, but moving forward, the situation will be better and actually wider because they're trying to expand to other countries. And like I've said, based on my situation here, a lot of people are already eating outside in restaurants. Mm-hmm. And I think their expansion to other countries will be beneficial for them, right? Not only in the long term, but in the short term, once it opens, really the demand will be there, right? And in terms of the fundraising exercise that they're doing right now, they're trying to, the proceeds for that one will be used for capital expenditure to open more stores, not only in the Philippines, but abroad. So that should be a good news for them, right? In terms of their preferred shares, at the end of the day, it's a good thing that Jollibee mentioned that it would not affect their annual cash dividend policy. So that should be good for investors right now, that they can be patient about the company, especially that their plans are quite clear on where they will use their funds.
Okay, and finally, the regulator SEC has green-lighted All Day Mart's 6 billion peso IPO and Petron's 50 billion peso fixed rate bonds offer. So many companies forming the beeline to raise funds. Is there enough appetite for these fundraising activities? Will investors bite?
Yeah, that depends, right? First of all, for IPOs, for, you know, we always tell our clients, you should not only take a look at the company and its prospect, you should also take a look at where will they use the proceeds. And we always tell them that if they use the proceeds mostly for expansion, and then that's good news. And then after that, that's where we tackle the specifics of the company. So for example, for all the terms of, I believe they're still planning out in terms of where they use the proceeds, but I've been reading it's a mix of debt repayment, it's a mix of opening more stores, right? And for all day, I would like to, you know, look into further the numbers moving forward in terms not only their plans, but how are they performing right now, mm-hmm. pre and during the pandemic.
The All Day Marts is actually offering up to 7 billion common shares, 80 centavos a piece. They're looking to raise around 5.8 billion pesos. The offer period is going to run from October 15 to 25, listing on November 3. We do know that All Day Marts currently has 33 stores with 55,881 square meters of sellable space. The target for them, to hit 45 stores by next year and 100 stores by 2026. Okay, Royce, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. I think you like this stock. Don't tell us, just describe. We're going to leave our viewers to guess what this is. So what do you have
to say? Very interesting company. This company has been outperforming share price-wise. Why we still like the company, why we think there's still upside to this company is because it's venturing to this segment, which is kind of trending not only in the developed countries, but in also other parts of the world, which they are exposed at. And then I think why we like this company also in terms of upside in the coming months and early next year is because it might be included not only in the PSCI, but in other indices like MSCI. So I think that's the best clue I can give.
Okay, for those who saw the chart, it's sort of a giveaway. You can see a very, very short span of trading for this stuff. One question though, Royce, the price has gone up so much. Is it too late to get on this train?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. So if we match both fundamental and technical analysis, actually we have a report for that you can accumulate this stock once it pulls back, right? 5 to 10% at current compared to current levels. But any pullbacks is a must buy for this company, given the catalyst of what I said and what are included in our report. So there's still upside.
That's the bottom. And pounds.
Exactly.
Okay, on that note, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Royce, thank you so much for joining us. Looking forward to speaking with you again soon.
Right. Thank you. Stay safe, everyone.
Stay safe. Now, time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers. From Business World, the Philippine National Oil Corporation says three areas in Mindanao could hold the potential for natural gas production. From Business Mirror, the Philippine Central Bank says the local banking sector has very little investment in China's real estate sector. Now, that statement comes amid a crisis hounding one of China's largest property developers, also its most indebted company, the Evergrande Group. And from the Wall Street Journal, Chinese authorities are reportedly asking local governments to prepare for the potential downfall of the Evergrande Group. Still to come, we'll talk about how StratPoint Technologies is helping Philippine enterprises make that digital shift. StratPoint Technologies CEO Mary Rose de la Cruz joins us when Market Edge returns.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Ranking slips in the top 100 list of emerging global startup ecosystems. Startup Genome's 2021 report showed the Philippine capital placed within the 91 to 100th rank, or those at earlier stages of growth. In last year's report, Manila was within the 31 to 40 rank. Mumbai, meanwhile, topped the list. The report said Manila's strengths are in financial technology and e-commerce and having affordable talent. The Trade Department vows to work on improving the performance of the Philippine startup ecosystem. Now, our next guest heads the Born in the Cloud Digital Transformation Enabler, StratPoint Technologies, Mary Rose de la Cruz. Thank you so much for joining us, Mary Rose. Good morning.
Good morning, Michelle. I'm so happy to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you for joining us. So why don't we go back in time and why don't you share with us your 30-second elevator pitch of your business? What is it that you do? Who are your clients? How are you making a difference?
Okay, so StratPoint is a Filipino tech company that competes globally. So what we do is we build modern applications and we leverage the cloud, data engineering, and AI technologies, artificial intelligence technologies to help companies digitally transform, right? Mm-hmm. And especially now in today's uncertain climate, now more than ever, we use technology to help companies be adaptive to change. And looking forward, really thrive and grow. And we know now that there's more appreciation that all of these hottest technologies are really essential to business. Even, you know, we already knew that before. Now it's essential work, right? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, StratPoint, we are a company that has its roots in Silicon Valley. And the top executives, we've worked in you know, the international global scene. And what we do in making a difference is really bring those technologies to the Philippines to help enterprises in the Philippines, while we also help, you know, global companies. We have clients actually in the US, in the Asia Pac region, as well as, you know, the top corporations here in the Philippines. So that's really our, how we make a difference in, we are a platform to elevate really technology, IT in the country.
In a country where 99% of business establishments are MSMEs, are Philippine companies, the big bulk, the small, medium enterprises, are they ready for the digital shift? Are they ready to take this seriously, to invest serious money in this? Because a lot of them are going at it alone. You know, cloud, right. they use their emails, they use social media selling. Are they ready to invest big and to take it to the next level, you think?
That's a good question. My view has always been that they have no choice, you know, it's here. There's no choice, they have to do it. And, you know, the competition is not just local and global, and all of, let's say, the barriers to entry that they have put up before, they're not going to work anymore. So my view is they have no choice and they need help. And that's why we're here at StratPoint. So even the SMEs, they'll find it very hard to hire their own software engineers in the cloud with the right level of expertise. That's mm-hmm. world-class standard. And that's where we come in. You know, mm-hmm. we build that expertise. We offer it to them.
Mary Rose, how have the applications of your products and services changed or evolved during the pandemic?
Well, for example, one thing I can say is that we didn't have that many retail customers prior to the pandemic, right? After the pandemic, we got a lot of retail customers. And, you know, makes sense for obvious reasons, right? Because they quickly had to shift online their retail businesses. So, you know, that is key. For financial services, that has always been a bread and butter kind of customer for us. But we experienced that they ramped up their requirements, needing more, you know, functionality, more of our services.
Mm-hmm. You know, you're doing your bit, really, to help build a digital Philippines. What to you is the biggest hurdle now at this point? Is it a mindset? Is it not having the right people with the right vision at the helm? I mean, you talk about going digital. Mary Rose, we can't even get our contact tracing app in order. So what to you is the biggest challenge now for the Philippines to level up and go digital meaningfully?
I think, you know how in times of crisis, you have to have the right leadership to move everyone forward because there's so many who are capable and willing to help. You know, having the right leadership and to drive it, I think, being able to work with anyone is key. You know, I think that in all of this, we've really not been able to harness the industry. You know, what's happened is that in fairness, there have been efforts, and we have to recognize that it's not an easy problem, right? In fact, even in computer science, which is my degree, it's pretty an intractable problem that we have, even in contact tracing. So, so you need really the best minds, all of us coming together. And I think that has been, you know, the hurdle, putting the structure for us to be able to come together. But so it's not insurmountable, It's not insurmountable, but I think that you need the right leadership with the technology background.
Do we have that?
To lead it. We have it. We have it, but I don't think that they are currently empowered to do that.
And speaking of leadership, as a woman in a predominantly male-led industry, which is tech, are there challenges that you feel are unique to you as a woman? I mean, when you talk to investors, do you get the surprised look that, oh, you're the head of a tech company? Or do you get a pushback because you're a woman?
Well, you know, I keep getting this question. It is a sad state of affairs that when if you're a woman and you're head of a, you know, tech company, that it's still, you know, it's a surprise. And I guess the hurdle is I have to always credentialize myself that, my undergrad is computer science. My postgrad degree is also in computer science. I'm a kind of a nerd, and there are many of us women who are like that, who are very capable. So I guess that's a bit of a hurdle. But in fairness, what I can say in the Philippines, the level of equality is higher than in, you know, like I work a lot with other Western countries. And I think that it's easier actually here in the Philippines. So that's
leaders like you.
Good question. But I haven't thought about that, but I don't think we do. When I look about the investors and, you know, there are a few and we know them, but in terms of number or percentage, right, it's pretty low. So you're quite right. I mean, women helping women in this network, we do it. I mean, for me, you know, I'm active in, you know, women who code and actually just getting women first into IT careers. And we have to start them very young, really at grade school, because I've seen that by the time you get to high school and college, it's too late. They have not considered tech a career. So So that's what also I'm doing and into to try to get them young.
Get them into STEM courses as well. And speaking of investors, I want to end with that, Mary Rose. I know at least three Filipino tech companies, also within your age range, because StratPoint is about 20 years old, right? 20
years
old,
that's
still,
right.
Also within that age range, who have recently welcomed big investors from Japan, from Singapore. What about StratPoint Technologies? Is that in the cards? Are you in talks with any investors to come in? Are you looking to list? Because the PSE has been really gung-ho about getting more companies to list, especially tech companies. We don't have enough of you listed on the exchange.
Yeah, well, you know, what I can say is that these are exciting times for us. You know? For a company like StratPoint that's born in the cloud, you know, all new technologies and the hottest technologies, we've generated a lot of interest, right? So I can say that, you know, this year alone and the end of last year, we've been in talks with several foreign investors interested in us. But of course, a listing in the PSE, you know, I won't say that's not a possibility. It could be in the cards because we know that the PSE is hungry for, you know, real tech companies, really, that can be exciting and, you know, at our size and current position, you know, I think, and our leadership, I think we qualify. But of course, you know, we have to figure out what's best for our shareholders.
Companies to list, especially tech companies. We don't have enough of you listed on the exchange.
Yeah, well, you know, what I can say is that these are exciting times for us. You know? For a company like StratPoint that's born in the cloud, you know, all new technologies and the hottest technologies, we've generated a lot of interest, right? So I can say that, you know, this year alone and the end of last year, we've been in talks with several foreign investors interested in us. But of course, a listing in the PSE, you know, I won't say that's not a possibility. It could be in the cards because we know that the PSE is hungry for, you know, real tech companies, really, that can be exciting and, you know, at our size and current position, you know, I think, and our leadership, I think we qualify. But of course, you know, we have to figure out what's best for our shareholders and also, more important, our employees who really drive all of this innovation. So, but yeah, exciting times, definitely.
And even more exciting the next time when we speak with you and introduce you as the newest tech unicorn from the Philippines. Looking forward to that day, Mary.
Yes, that's our dream. Thank you so much,
Michelle. Everybody's dream. Thank you so much.
That's our dream.
Thank you so much for joining us and good luck. Stay safe.
Okay, you too.
Okay, and before we go, for those who tried to guess your blind item, this is the stock pick of Royce Aguilar. This is Monde Nissin. Do let us know if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that is it for the show. I'm Michelle Ong. Thank you so much for watching. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Market Edge podcast. Available now on Spotify. You can also watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe. Have a great weekend, everybody, and stay with ANC.
This week on Cityscape, we're giving you a rundown of what's been happening in the beauty scene. We've got a peek at hot new launches, something for the gents, and so much more. Catch all these and more on a brand new episode of